Robby Mook was Hillary Clinton's campaign manager for her bid for the White House in 2016. Terry Sullivan was Marco Rubio's campaign manager back in 2016 on that presidential run. And they both join us at the table. Good morning, gentlemen.
Morning.
Good morning.
So, Robby, let's start with you. What did you think of that exchange between Warren and Biden? Warren and Sanders.
I was going to say, I don't know that there was one. Look, this fire had started burning before the debate. I was a little surprised. I thought maybe Warren would try to make more of this, but I thought she actually handled it quite well. You know,
she made a lot of it. I mean, she didn't throw him any kind of lifeline.
Well,
he said he didn't say it.
Both delivery. Like the first one, you know, the first one, she clearly scripted it. She probably scripted it with Klobuchar, but the real scripted thing was afterwards, after the debate was over, the camera still rolling, and she goes up and refuses to shake his hand. I mean, that's not an accident.
That was deliberate.
Yeah, she's not an amateur. She knows the cameras are on. She did that on purpose, and she made her point. I mean, that was her goal.
Yeah, and here's the thing. Look, the attack is Bernie thinks a woman can't be president. She never said that again. Right. She just let it stand
and then addressed it. She said it's a fact.
And then she talked about, hey, the two women on this stage are the ones who've never lost an election.
We've been talking for a while about when the point would come that they would essentially have to go after each other. Obviously, we've reached that point. Why is that, do you think, now?
Yeah, well, but here's what was interesting. They were kind of going after each other more at the last debate. I found this debate quite subdued, but I thought they would go after each other more.
Even more.
We're late. We're a month out, but it's so close.
You know? I think the reason is there was nobody in there to throw a haymaker that needed to, because I mean everybody's in the margin of error in Iowa right now. Of the four candidates on that stage who really should have been on that stage, it was all a margin of error kind of thing in Iowa, and so no one wants to make a big move or a big mistake. It's all battle of inches because any one of them could win Iowa.
What does it mean, 19 days away from Iowa, where there really still really is no clear front runner? Right. What does it mean for the Democrats?
Look, I think what each of them does matters differently. If Joe Biden wins Iowa, this is game over.
Game over, Terry?
I really believe that because if the national front runner who's got leads in plenty of other further states down in a national lead in most polls can win in Iowa. Look, there's only been two Democrats to win the nomination in the past 50 years that didn't win Iowa first. It matters.
And Iowa has always had a winnowing effect, right? In 2004, John Kerry won there, and then it was just kind of over after that. In 2008, it came down to Obama and Hillary. You know, I think we'll see one of those two scenarios where we're down to two or three people and it goes on. Or I agree, if Biden wins, it's probably over.
What did you guys think about the debate, actually? You know, you said it was very subdued. A lot of people are calling it a snoozer this morning.
Yeah, subdued is code for boring, right?
Yeah, I know. It's a very diplomatic way. But wouldn't you think that somebody would be trying to make some kind of splash right before Iowa? Did it surprise you that nobody seemed to go for it?
Yeah, because Terry said there are four front runners right now. Maybe those folks don't want to change the dynamic, but you had seven people on the stage. I just expected someone there who says, okay, look, change and risk is a good thing. I'm down. I got to move up. I got to try something different. I didn't feel that.
The impeachment trial starts next week.
Right.
Yeah. That's going to pull three of these senators out of Iowa because they're going to have to be in D.C. How's that going to change the dynamic?
Dramatically. I mean, look, if you're not on the ground for an entire month or I guess 2 weeks before Iowa and then even longer for New Hampshire, that shuts these campaigns down.
Yeah.
The most valuable thing they have at this point is their candidates' time, and they've just been erased. This notion that they can somehow get out there, it takes an hour to get to Dulles, which is where the private planes are flying out of. At 5 o'clock rush hour traffic in D.C., it might take more. You've got a two-hour flight. I mean, this is not realistic that they can go out there and campaign after hours.
And a trial is supposed to be 6 days a week. They're not supposed to talk about it.
And one thing, stay awake. They're supposed to stay awake. How are they going to do that when they're out campaigning late at night?
Yeah. And one thing we haven't talked about here, these volunteers and activists who are in that caucus room, because you know, this isn't a private ballot. It's a bargaining session.
Right.
They're so important. And when you're not there to pump them up, you know, that's a strategic disadvantage.
Right.
So I'm interested to see how people use their time in D.C. Social media, are they live streaming? You know, how do they connect?
Yeah. It'll be interesting. All right. Robby Mook, Terry Sullivan, thank you both.